Yes, guys, we are live again. Please log in fast. Nikita, I will explain the logic. Just give me a second until people are logged in. Yeah, Arun, we are back. I am expecting others also to be back soon. Please fast. Very fast. How come these timestamps are not showing the right time, man? According to my clock, it's only 8:54. The timestamp on your message is showing as 9:02. And Nikita, I think Shashi has replied to your message. I think this way of communication is even better when the students are replying to themselves. Yeah, I'll just elaborate on what Shashi said. Okay. So what we intend here is, yes, when equity shares are fixed, then why is it a financial liability is what Nikita asked. Logic is quite simple, man. When I say that the consideration is not fixed, when I said $10,000, I don't know what is the value of $10,000 at the end of year 5. Yes, I am issuing equity shares, I agree. But what is the number of equity shares, even though I know what is the issue price of each share? I cannot tell you what is the issue price of each share until and unless the consideration for the share is fixed. If the consideration of the share is variable, that means it can be $10,000 into 70 rupees or 72 rupees or 75 rupees or 80 rupees. I have no idea what it is. So then the consideration is variable and I am trying to issue a fixed number of equity shares, then in such case, I don't know what is the issue price, therefore I'll still continue to call it as a financial liability. I will only call it as an equity instrument when I know what is the consideration for which I'm issuing the equity share and how many shares I'm issuing. If only these two are fixed, the consideration and the number of equity shares, then I will call it as an equity instrument. I'll move on further. I think we have people live already. Yeah. Not all, but it's fine. Let's go on. They will join subsequently. Now, as you progress from here on, now look at this logic now. When I am looking at financial liabilities and equity instruments, there you might find that majority of the items are going into financial liability and a very rarely or a very few instruments are coming into the logic of equity, correct? But however, there are certain restrictions. For classification as financial liability. What are the restrictions for classification as a financial liability? Now, I will come out with a word which might be the very first time that you're hearing to this. Puttable financial instrument. I know you're hearing to this word for the very first time, most of you. I'll explain what is a puttable financial instrument. Puttable financial instrument is one of a restriction from classification as a financial liability. The second restriction is perpetual debt instrument. I'll explain each one of them. Number three, instruments which are redeemable only on liquidation or winding up. Three examples or three restrictions which I put up from classification as a financial liability. One is puttable financial instrument. Second one is perpetual debt. Third one is instruments which will be redeemed only on winding up of a company or on liquidation of a company. Now let's talk about in parts. First of all, what is a puttable financial instrument? What is its logic? This name itself is so not so pleasing to the ear because it's the first time that you're looking at this word. A puttable financial instrument has two very important characteristics. Two very, very important characteristics which a puttable financial instrument has. There's nothing but puttable or put back in the sense. When I use this word put back is nothing but redemption. Okay, no other term, but it only means redemption. The word used is called as puttable, but in sense it's nothing but put back is nothing but redemption and nothing else. So when I say puttable financial instrument, where the issuer has a right to put back, has a right to put back the instrument at his will. What did I say? The word put back means nothing but redeem. Who is the issuer? An enterprise who issued the financial instrument has a right to redeem the instrument whenever they want it. Now, I've given you an instrument. I said, this you subscribe it for 1 lakh. And I said, sir, fine. When will you give me my money back? When I want it. I will give your money back when I want to give it. That is called as puttable financial instrument. So the issuer of the instrument has a right to redeem the instrument at his will, then I call him as a puttable financial instrument. Second, or the instrument will put back only on liquidation, either I am saying that it will put back at the will of the issuer. That means the issuer, whenever he wants to redeem the instrument, he can redeem. If he doesn't want to redeem the instrument, he need not redeem the instrument. Or the instrument will redeem or will put back only on liquidation of the enterprise or only on winding up of the enterprise. It will not redeem or it will not put back at any point earlier than that. Then in such situation, you will say that such kind of instruments are called as puttable financial instruments. Guys, though they are restricted as far as companies act, if you look at irredeemable preference shares. What do you mean by irredeemable preference shares? There's no particular time limit. However, it is restricted as per Companies Act, because Companies Act says that you cannot have a debt instrument or a debenture or a preference share beyond a period of 20 years, correct? But if I had a right to issue irredeemable debentures, then they will only be redeemed at the option of the enterprise or at the time of liquidation of the enterprise, such instruments or such irredeemable debentures normally come into the logic or normally come into the ambit of puttable financial instruments, which cannot be redeemed at the time at the wish of the owner of the instrument or the holder of the instrument, or they cannot be redeemed after a fixed maturity date. Then such instruments will be called as puttable financial instruments. Is it possible under in the current Indian environment? Absolutely no. Companies Act is there, which will protect the rights of the holder, which says that you cannot have puttable financial instruments. You should always give the right to redeem after a particular maturity date or at the option of the holder of the instrument, not at the option of the issuer of the instrument. Clear? Redemption at the option of the issuer or the enterprise who has issued the instrument is a clear condition or a clear indication of puttable financial instrument, which can never be classified as equity instrument. Therefore, these puttable financial instruments will always be classified as equity instruments. Clear? Now look at those three logics which I gave you. Perpetual debt, exactly the same logic. What do you mean by perpetual debt? Perpetual debt means there is no maturity for the debt. I will keep on paying interest and the debt will continue and continue and continue. When will you repay the debt? Perpetual debt it is. It doesn't get repaid. It will get repaid probably at a later point of time whenever I want to repay, or at the time of liquidation of the company, I will repay. Otherwise, I will not repay the instrument at all. Instrument redeemable only upon liquidation or winding up of a company. So until then, you cannot redeem the instrument. There is no fixed maturity date. When will the liquidation happen? Even I don't know when the liquidation will happen. When it happens, then I will redeem. Then in such situation, there is no maturity date at all. In such kind of situation, you will come across this concept as a clear case of equity instrument and cannot be called as a financial liability at all. Is it possible in Indian environment? Absolutely no. None of puttable financial instruments, perpetual debt, instruments which are redeemable only upon liquidation are not possible in Indian environment, because Companies Act has put in strict guidelines saying that you cannot issue a debt instrument which is for a period of more than 20 years. Clear indication, clear instructions, guidelines, making sure that these concepts are not prevalent in India. Then why did you discuss when they are not prevalent in India? Guys, this is an international standard. It is basically a reference of IFRS 9 and IAS 32, which I am talking about. So internationally, these standards are being formulated. So these paragraphs are being inserted as it is into our IND AS 32 and IND AS 109. But what is its relevance in Indian environment is absolute zero. But since I wanted to bring it to you, since it is a part of the standard, I'm just bringing it to you. Yes, Arun, even in the case of residual interest, there will be a variability in equity instrument. Yes, there is a variance because you don't know what is the amount that you'll take. That's why you call it as equity instrument. Let's slightly talk about an example. Let's say I am looking at a preference share, okay? Again, I'll roll back to your logics of CPTs or foundations, where your preference share was of two types. One type of preference share is basically a redeemable preference share. One is basically your irredeemable preference share. Redeemable preference shares again had three ways. The redemption can happen on fixed maturity dates, or at the option of holder. This is also possible. At the option of holder is very much possible. They are called as demand instruments. properly as per even your current prevailing Indian laws, it is possible. Or at the option of issuer, this is where the restriction comes up, you cannot issue this. In the first two scenarios, on a fixed maturity date or at the option of the holder of the option of the holder of the instrument is called as demand liability. Okay, learn this word. It is called as demand liability. You will get this word in Ind AS 1, guys. You will get it in Ind AS 1 when they have to define a current asset and a current liability. Under current liabilities, you find this demand liability. On a fixed date or at the option of the holder, these are classified as financial liability. But if I look at this logic, it is redeemable at the option of the issuer, or it is irredeemable, that means it will be redeemed only on liquidation. It is redeemed only on liquidation of the enterprise. In such situation, I'll classify this as equity instrument. So there I get the difference between an equity instrument and a financial liability. If I'm just taking different ways of preference shares being redeemed, or multiple ways of preference shares that we have already learned in the past as far as our foundations are concerned. So this is predominantly what we can understand here. Arun and Monica, I think let's stop the discussion on fixed or fixed test. I'll come back to fixed or fixed test if there's a further discussion which is required on that. And take this down. So I started with restriction on classification as financial liability, putable financial instrument where they can be redeemed only at the option of the issuer, or they will be only redeemed upon liquidation, or perpetual debt instrument, there is no fixed maturity date for them. Number three, instruments which will be repaid only or redeemed only upon liquidation of the enterprise or winding up of the company. In such cases, we normally come across this logic as restriction from classification as financial liability. They will only be classified as equity instruments. I kindly refresh if it went offline. Kindly refresh, it will be visible. Now that equity and financial liability, we are trying to separate, we are trying to have that kind of discussion between equity and financial liability. Now I will complicate this concept by bringing in the concept of compound financials. What do you mean by compound? Earlier in chemistry, probably in schooling, maybe you might have heard about this, called as chemical compounds. Chemical compounds means two or more compounds are stuck together. So same logic appears even here as compound financial instrument. When I say compound financial instrument, there is an equity and a financial liability which are working together, which are existing together in a particular instrument. Then we call it as compound financial instrument. Compound financial instrument. What do you mean by compound financial instrument? A compound financial instrument is nothing but an instrument in which there is an equity component surplus a debt or financial liability component that coexist in an instrument. What are coexisting? An instrument has two parts. There is an equity part and there is a debt or financial liability part. Both of them are coexisting together in one single instrument. Then you call it as compound financial instrument. Compound financial instrument is where an equity and a financial liability, both of them coexist. The first thing that we need to understand is examples for this. Tell me, where does it happen? So, instruments with fixed maturity but discretionary returns. What do you mean by discretionary returns? Discretionary returns in the sense the return depends upon the discretion of the enterprise. I will decide how much I have to give you. I will not tell you that I will pay a certain amount. When I look at this logic here, fixed maturity, when I look at this logic, this fixed maturity makes it look like a debt instrument or a financial liability. But when I look at discretionary returns, that means it is at the option of the issuer, then it will make me look like it is equity instrument. It will make me look like as if it is an equity instrument. Just a second, guys. I think the pen is blotting for some reason. Instrument with fixed maturity and discretionary returns is first example which I can give you. Another example which I can give you is perpetual instruments with fixed returns. There is no discretionary return. It's a fixed return which is promised upon to the holder of the instrument. When I look at this word fixed return, I will know that it is a debt or a financial liability part. But when I see that it is a perpetual instrument, that means it will keep on going on and on until there is no maturity. So until the liquidation of the company, this becomes an equity component. Then if I look at one more example, one genuine example which everyone will start looking at instrument with fixed returns and conversion option. Option to convert into equity shares or compulsory convertible into equity share. This conversion into equity share makes it equity instrument, but my fixed returns will start giving me a dimension of debt or financial liability. Take an example like this. A company has issued 10 lakh worth of debentures carrying a return of 8% paid annually, which has a maturity date of 5 years, and at the end of 5 years, they have an option to get converted into equity share. That option to get converted into equity share is an equity component which is embedded into a debenture out there. So it's an equity and a liability both existing together. Then in such situation, what are we supposed to do? Whenever we look at this compound financial instrument, we will start applying something called as split accounting. What do you mean by a split accounting? In genuine simple sense, a split accounting is nothing but where that single instrument is broken down and identified into how much is the debt component or a financial liability component, and how much is the equity component in it. Because both of them have to be shown separately. Equity component should be presented under shareholder funds, while the financial liability component or a debt component will be presented under non-current or current liabilities depending upon their maturity date. Now, how do I do this split? How do I know how much to be allocated in each case? When I said 10 lakh worth of debentures, which has a conversion option, but has a fixed returns of 8% every year, then 10 lakh value, how do I split this 10 lakhs? Saying that this much is debt and this much is equity, how will I know? Now that is where we come. So let's talk about it. I will always try to find the debt or financial liability component. It should be measured by using sum of the cash flows into present value factor. So first of all, identify the stream of fixed cash flows, identify the year in which such cash flow arises, multiply it with the present value factor out there. The sum of everything will become my debt component. Then what is equity component? You cannot calculate equity component using any particular logic, but in simple sense, equity component is equal to value of instrument. What is the total value of that instrument? Like I gave you the example in the case of debenture, it was 10 lakhs minus the debt or financial liability component part. That is nothing but balancing figure and nothing else. This is called as split accounting. Why do you need to do this split accounting? This split accounting is necessary because my debt component will be classified under non-current or current liability, while my equity part will go into shareholder fund. Under other equity. If you remember, while I was writing the balance sheet at the beginning of the session, I told you, I'll tell you why reserves and surplus became other equity and what is the significance of using the word other equity and not using the word reserves and surplus. Guys, reserve and surplus is something that you generate during your operations of the business. I got some profit. I issued shares at premium. But whenever I'm talking about other equity, it is not necessarily always something that the enterprise earns. It might be something which the enterprise issued, but might have an equity component which is embedded into it. Now, someone who is talking at the logic of present value factor might ask me, what should be the discount rate? If I don't know the discount rate, I cannot calculate what is the present value factor only. My discount rate is equal to effective interest rate. Right? Effective interest rate in the sense, if I issue debentures with a conversion option, then it takes into the standard assumes that a debenture with a conversion option is always carrying a lower rate of interest than an alternative debenture without a conversion option. With a conversion option, if I issued the debenture at 8%, without the conversion option, then the share debenture would have been same class of debenture would have been issued at 10% and not at 8%. So therefore, the effective interest rate and the actual interest rate are significantly different whenever you have this debt and equity component which are mixed into one single instrument. One of the very famous examples I'll give you to explain this split accounting, guys. Guys, any doubts, you can keep going on for this part. I'm looking at your chat. Yes, guys, I'll go back once again and I just explain what happened till now. So where we were talking about compound financial instrument, I said it is an instrument where the equity and the liability component coexist. What do you mean by equity and liability component coexisting? I gave you a simple example of debenture which is having a fixed maturity date but has an option to get converted into equity share. So that option to convert into equity share is an equity component. Having a fixed maturity date and fixed stream of returns is always talking about a financial liability. So there I've given you three examples of such kind of compound financial instrument where an instrument has a fixed maturity but has a discretionary return. That means how much I will give you a return, I don't know. I will definitely redeem the debenture after 5 years. Throughout the 5 years period, I'll give you a return according to what I want you to give. What I want to give you. So it is at the option of the issuer, the return, therefore it is equity. But there is a fixed maturity date upon which I have to compulsory pay out the value, therefore it is a debt or a financial liability. Perpetual instrument, that means there is no maturity, it is an equity instrument, but it has a fixed return. So therefore that return which is fixed is always a stream of cash flows which indicate a debt or a financial liability. Third one, like I already told you, instruments which have fixed returns but have an option to convert, so that fixed returns becomes a financial liability, option to convert will become an equity instrument. Whenever this debt and equity instruments stay together, we apply something called as split accounting. What is split accounting? That instrument which is compound instrument, I will break down the instrument into two parts. One is called as the debt part or the financial liability part. One part is the equity part. The debt or financial liability will form part of my non-current or current liabilities, while the equity component will form part of other equity under shareholder funds in the balance sheet. Now, how do I split? How do I know that the total value of the instrument, this much is debt and this much is equity? For splitting it, I'll first try to talk about or quantify what is the financial liability. Equity part, I don't have to quantify, because if I know what is the debt part, the balance of the instrument is always equity. How do you calculate debt or financial liability? Debt or financial liability is nothing but a sum of all cash flows multiplied by present value factors, and that present values are normally calculated using a discount rate called as effective interest rate. It is nothing but market rate of return is called as effective rate of interest. What is the equity component? Once you know the debt component, you know what is the total value of the instrument. This is the debt component, then the balance amount in the instrument should be the equity component. Guys, I see that it's going offline all the time again and again. I'll just stop the stream and I'll start streaming once again. Just a second, guys. Give me 1 second. Yeah, so whenever we have this compound financial instrument where a debt and a equity component will coexist, we'll have to first make sure that we are splitting between debt and equity component. Let's try to understand with the help of an example. You'll understand it better if I do it with an example. I'll take an example here. Let's say in the example, I am talking about a debenture with a conversion option. Debenture basically is debt, but the conversion option indicates equity. Rate of return, or the coupon rate, is what we call as interest. I'll take it as 8% per annum, which is payable annually. Right? And then I'll say that maturity is after 5 years. Right? And I'll say that similar debenture without conversion option carries 10% interest. Therefore, that is nothing but my effective interest. This is nothing but effective interest rate. Okay? Guys, this problem, I'll solve it in two ways, okay? My first method of solving it is when I take compulsory conversion or conversion at the option of holder . The holder can choose if he wants to convert or not. Other one which I've given you first is compulsory convertible. That means there is no option. Has to compulsory convert into equity shares upon 5 years of maturity. Let's look at the stream of cash flows and how do we calculate. Here, when I calculate debt or financial liability, I'll calculate like this. Over 5 years period, I will get a fixed cash flow of how much, I did not give you the face value of debentures, right? Let's say the face value of debentures was about 10 lakhs. Okay. They carry a rate of interest of 8% payable annually on that entire value of 10 lakhs. 8%, if I calculate, 80,000 is your rate of interest, correct? So this 80,000 rupee which I am going to get, I'll get every year for 5 years. Therefore, I will calculate with PVAF, present value annuity factor, for effective interest 10% over 5 years. And once I multiply with this, I should be getting what is the value of the liability out there. Then what is equity then? Then the question will be, what is equity then? Then equity is nothing but the total amount of instrument that is 10 lakhs minus the debt value or financial liability value which you calculate. Okay. But if the conversion is at the option of the holder, I'm talking about this right side part, then I'll put it like this. Debt part is 80,000 into PVAF 10,5. This is correct. There is no doubt about this because I'll have to pay 80,000 over 5 years. That is for sure. But since the conversion is at the option of the holder, then enterprise might have an obligation to pay the entire amount of the instrument at the end of 5 years. Plus, how much will I have to prepay? I'll have to repay the entire 10 lakhs at the end of 5th year. So I will not apply PVAF, but instead I'll apply PVF. So two streams of cash flows I'll calculate. One stream of cash flow for interest, one stream of cash flow for the amount of total amount. If I look at the Excel, I'll work it out in Excel and I'll tell you what is the values. You can take down till here. If those who have a calculator, you can keep on going. And take down till here so that I'll turn to an Excel sheet and I'll start doing the computations. I hope you can see my Excel sheet, guys. I'll just improve the size of this so that it becomes visible to everyone. Yes, now. Let's improve upon the font as well. Okay. Yes, guys. So I'm here to try to find out what is the debt and equity form component. So I'm just putting out my heading. First one, I'm saying compulsory convertible. Second one, I'm putting up the heading as convertible at the option of holder. Okay. Now you check this out. First, I'm trying to calculate what is the debt or financial liability. So now let's try to calculate now. Your cash flows. I think I'll have to shift this somewhere because I have to calculate more. Your cash flows. Discount factor and discounted cash flow. Let's see now. Year one, up to 5 years, I have a same stream of cash flows. What is the cash flow every year? I'm looking at the example which I've given you, where I'm talking about 8% of return annually on 10 lakhs of face value. So it kept on giving me 80,000 rupees of cash flow as interest every year. What is the discount factor? I took an effective interest rate as 10% for similar debentures without conversion option. So is equal to 1 divided by 1.1. So I just got the discount rate. I'm just trying to make sure that I'm getting the further discount rate as well. I will make sure that I'll take it to 2 decimals. So what is my discounted cash flow now? So my total debt is nothing but the sum of all these discounted cash flows, that is cash flows into discount rate. There I got it at around 3 lakh 3,000, correct? That 3 lakh 3,000 is basically my debt component. It is my debt component out there. Then what is the equity component in it? Then the equity component is a very simple logic which I have to apply. My equity component is equal to $10 lakhs, which you already know is the value of your instrument, minus the 3 lakh 3,000. So 6 lakh 96,737 will become my value of debt the equity component, and this will be debt component. While this debt component, I will normally put it under non-current liability. While this equity component, I'll take it under other equity under shareholder funds. If I would have considered it as compulsory convertible, if I would have considered it to be compulsory convertible, then my logics would have been completely different, guys. I'll tell you what is the logic, why it goes completely different. I'm just trying to fit it into one screen. I can take the same stream of cash flows and the same discount rate even here. I can take the same stream of cash flows and the same discount rate even here. But however, there is one single change that will happen. That is, in year 5, I'll get extra cash flow. What is that extra cash flow that you're going to get? I'll just insert a line out here so that you'll understand the difference, guys. In the year 5, I'll get an extra cash flow, which is important to understand. Since it is at the option of the holder of the holder of the instrument can definitely order the company to repay back the entire value of the instrument, that is his 10 lakhs. So once he offers to ask him the entire 10 lakhs out at the end of 5th year, then again I'll have to apply the same 5th year discount rate and I'll try to identify what is the total value. Then I will get what is the total value of the instrument, which should be classified as debt. So this part again should be going into the concept of non-current liability. Then what is the equity instrument out of this, which should be going under other equity? You know that the total value of the instrument is how much? 10 lakhs, correct? Out of this, how much is the debt component? 9,24,000. So 75,815 will become my equity component in the entire instrument. So if you observe again, I'll explain what I did as far as the computations are concerned. Yes, guys. So when I took compulsory convertible options or compulsory convertible debentures, yes, guys. So when I took the concept of compulsory convertible, debentures, then what I have done is I made sure that the cash flows, which are having multiple stream of cash flows for 5 years, I only considered the interest components. I did not consider the terminal cash flow, that is a repayment of the debenture at all. If I would have considered the repayment of the debenture of 10 lakhs, then it would be a different answer. But however, the repayment of 10 lakhs or the terminal cash flow at the end of year 5, I have considered when I am taking convertible, if the options are convertible at the option of the holder of the instrument. Because the holder can demand the instrument or can demand the enterprise to pay back the value of the instrument rather than opting for conversion. Therefore, that also is an obligation of the enterprise to pay cash. What is the obligation of enterprise to pay cash under compulsory convertible? Only obligation is towards interest. The enterprise does not have an obligation to repay the entire value of the instrument on the maturity of the instrument. Therefore, if you look at it, I have made sure that there is a clear demarcation with the 5th cash flow or the terminal cash flow when the option becomes convertible at the option of the holder of the instrument. So whatever is the value of the debt is nothing but a sum of all the stream of cash flows multiplied by the discount factors, while the equity component is nothing but the difference amount or 10 lakhs minus the equity component. If you basically add back these two, the equity component and the debt component, you have to return back to your same 10 lakh concept. That is the concept. This is exactly the same concept that you'll apply everywhere. Now, why do I need this compound instrument and why do I need this debt accounting? Because the instrument has both debt and financial liability, debt or financial liability and equity part which is coexisting. It is necessary for me to identify what is a debt component and classify it under liabilities. And it is very necessary for me to identify the equity component and classify it under the concept of other equity. Clear? So this is something that you can pick up from here. So this is the same answer which I was talking about. So let me write the answer since I have the numbers. you could have preferred to do it on your calculator, no problem. Maybe the answer would be 10 numbers here and there or decimal places here and there. That's absolutely fine. 303263 is the answer here. If this is 303263, then my equity amount will become 6,96,737. Yes, if I'm looking at option of conversion is with the holder of the instrument, your debt will be much higher, which you have already calculated, because the debt component will include a terminal cash flow of 10 lakhs. So 9,24,184. What is the equity component then? My equity component would be 75,816. This is equity and debt component. Yeah, guys, all those who missed it in the session of live, I am anyways recording the session, so you people can get it from there. No issues regarding that. You people can be tension free regarding that. I'm uploading it on Facebook right now. Right away, I'll be uploading it on Facebook, guys. This is the concept of split accounting. And this is the entire concept relating to our compound financial instruments, where we have a debt and equity component which is coexisting. That will bring us to the end of today's session, guys. We will have to further talk about what is a classification of financial assets and classification of financial liabilities. But before signing off today, I will have to make sure that you people have missed this a bit of session. No problem. The backup facility is always there. If the live does not really reach you at a point of time, maybe the internet lags, sometimes there are technical issues. No problem, because offline, I am anyway recording the entire session. That recorded session will be available to you. Since this is a free session, I am putting it to you live across on YouTube right after this moment. So you can tune into YouTube. You can please check that the YouTube one works. Thank you, guys. I'll see you tomorrow for the further session.